Appalachian Unsolved Special. For the United States' most prolific serial killer, murder was an obsession. Samuel Little admitted to killing 93 women in a 35-year killing spree across America. His victims included at least two women in East Tennessee, but he never was charged with their crimes. Little was a cruel man who thought of nothing of humiliating Knoxville women, including one woman who lay dying. We take a closer look at what you want to see, but first, a warning. This story is graphic and disturbing.
Everybody described him as really a nice, gentle person when you first met him. Slick, I mean, a good talker, able to talk his way out of into things.
Sometime around Christmas 1974, a killer came to town. By the time he left, he'd notched another victim. A drifter, a thief, Ohio native Samuel Little murdered Knoxvillian Martha Cunningham, likely on New Year's Eve night, 1974. Little preyed on prostitutes, addicts. Cunningham was no prostitute, but she was vulnerable, a woman of God cursed to cross paths with a serial killer. Family members had last heard from her that New Year's Eve night. The 34-year-old was supposed to be at church on Parkview Avenue.
From what he told us was that he had seen her on more than one occasion. And then on New Year's Eve, he brought her out to the woods, strangled her, and killed her.
Veteran lawman David Davenport suspects Little drove her from the Magnolia area, heading east about 15 minutes toward remote woods off Oglesby Road, a spot where no one could hear her above the drone of nearby Interstate 40. He left her body splayed on the ground. Little treated her like so many of his victims, robbing her of any dignity, leaving her slip and dress up over her chest and her stockings and panties pulled down to her thighs. No respect, no regard. Hunters found her body more than 3 weeks later. Fate would deal Martha Cunningham another indignity. Records show authorities didn't investigate her death as a homicide. Despite the circumstances, out by herself in a remote location in a disheveled state, investigators found no signs of foul play. The autopsy's conclusion, quote, no obvious cause of death was noted. Decades passed, eventually only family and friends remembered Martha Cunningham. And then in 2018, Little decided it was time to confess. Once prosecutors promised Little they wouldn't seek the death penalty, he started talking about all the horrors he had inflicted. Not one, not 10, not 20 killings. No, he confessed to murdering 93 women starting in 1970 when he was 30 years old. He drew pictures of many of their faces, claiming he had a photographic memory.
He really wanted me to move out of there. So we, instead of going in there, I took her the other way.
To the surprise of Knox County investigators, his confessions included Cunningham, who he remembered as Martha. The FBI alerted the sheriff's office. Working cold cases for the county, Davenport checked out Little's story.
He gave us so many things about her that made us believe that he was telling the truth.
The old convict claimed he'd also killed a black prostitute in Knoxville around the same time.
And from what he described, he dumped her body somewhere in the city limits of Knoxville, but we never could find anything that fit that description.
That woman's body has never been found.
Samuel Little died in a Texas prison at the age of 80 back in 2020. Investigative journalist and my colleague John North has worked many of these Appalachian unsolved cases. And John, let's talk about this case in particular, mishandled from the get-go.
It's kind of extraordinary and a travesty, to be honest with you, John. I mean, if you come upon a victim who is lying there, been dead several weeks, their genitals are exposed, their clothing clearly has been pulled down, you don't think it's a natural.
You don't. Let's talk about other things that stood out to you in this case in particular.
Well, one thing that strikes me is, well, first of all, we didn't even know that it was a homicide. We had completely forgotten, the investigators had, about this case until Samuel Little himself came forward and said, essentially, oh, by the way, I killed a woman in Knoxville, Tennessee in 1975. That's just amazing. And it was the cold case investigator in 2018 then had to go back and try to assemble what Samuel Little had been telling him.
John, we're going to get to it in a second, but technology is helping solve more of these cases.
Yeah, it's incredible. Almost every day now we are seeing breaks locally, statewide, nationally in cases, simply because DNA profiling has become so much more sophisticated.
Samuel Little confessed to murdering 93 people across the United States. Over the next three nights, we'll tell the story of America's deadliest serial killer like you've never seen before.
We are tracing his first steps into crime right here in Northeast Ohio. Investigator Sarah Goldenberg tracked down one detective who never forgot him and opened up in dramatic fashion about that encounter.
Here's episode one of To Catch a Killer, Samuel Little.
Samuel Little preyed on the women he said society wouldn't miss. The convicted serial killer's victims were prostitutes and drug addicts. Seven murders here in Ohio, and the identity of one woman is still a mystery. These are the faces of just some of the victims sketched by serial killer Samuel Little. His run-ins with the law started as a child. Burglaries and robberies dot his time in Northeast Ohio. In the beginning, nothing hinted at the serial killer behind them. But for one local detective, something was off.
So unusual that I felt the need to add additional information in the report.
Samuel Little was born in 1940 in Georgia. He grew up with his grandmother in Lorain, Ohio, and says he was abandoned as a baby by his mother, who was a prostitute. 19 News learned Little went to Hawthorne Junior High School, but at 16 years old, he landed in a juvenile detention center. In 1961, he got 3 years for robbing a Lorain furniture store, then crisscrossed the nation, surviving on petty crime. It wasn't until the 1970s he started killing, but he always came home. In 1984, Little hit the Higbees at Midway Mall in Elyria, shoplifting 14 pairs of jeans worth more than $300. 19 News tracked down the now retired detective who made the arrest.
There was something about this guy that just made me uncomfortable, and I've jokingly said it made the spidey sense tingle.
Alan Leiby spent more than two decades working for Elyria Police. 35 years later, he still remembers running into Little. On Little's arrest sheet, Leiby wrote this note titled Reference to Bond, an apparent reference to the crime-ridden road Little was on.
He has receipts in his possession from Delaware County Jail in Ohio and Trutland County Jail in Georgia. He claims intoxication but has a cast on his right leg and negotiates very well with it. Minor odor of alcohol on his person and is very articulate about why he was stealing.
Little told police he was a self-employed painter and had been married once.
He was very articulate and very cooperative. He was just a very easy guy to get along with.
Decades went by and Little faded from his memory until police reached out to him a couple of years ago. Leiby learned Little was much more than a petty thief.
Do you think he wanted that recognition?
Absolutely. Absolutely. He wants to be famous, and now he is.
The killings could have stopped in 1982 when police in Pascagoula, Mississippi arrested Little for the murder of Melinda LaPree. But they didn't have enough evidence at the time and he walked free. A jury also found him not guilty in 1984 for a Florida murder.
How does someone like this continue to move around the country and continue to wreak this carnage and not have any of these charges stick enough to take him off the street?
That same year, police say Little strangled and tried to kill Lori Barros in San Diego. She survived the attack, and so did another woman attacked a month later. Little only served 2.5 years in prison and then moved to LA, where he went on to kill more women in the 80s.
But society doesn't see those people.
So he picked people that he thought no one would notice if they were gone.
But in 2012, somebody noticed. Los Angeles police arrested Little on a drug charge, and Detective Mitzi Roberts pieced together three unsolved homicides with new DNA samples from Little.
Once we knew what we were dealing with, which was a violent offender, a serial killer, then it became very important for us to get this guy in custody.
19 News got an inside look at the investigation that started it all. from the LA District Attorney's Office. We found Little has been arrested about 75 times for crimes from theft to rape to homicide. We obtained these photos of the crime scenes and evidence. The three victims killed in a 5-mile radius south of downtown LA. Little lived just miles away at the time. In July 1987, Little killed Carol Alford. Her body was found in this alley, and police collected this bra and shirt she was wearing as evidence. Little murdered Audrey Nelson 2 years later. Her body was found in a dumpster in this restaurant parking lot. Fingernail clippings show she fought back, getting Little's DNA under her nails. The next month, the body of Guadalupe Apodaca was found inside an abandoned auto repair shop. This yellow shirt she was wearing marked as evidence. A judge sentenced Little to 3 life sentences for the murders, but he denied he killed those women. Here's victim Carol Alford's daughter.
It's closure for me. I know for me, if it's nobody else, it's for me.
In his case file, prosecutors wrote, wherever the defendant travels, he leaves behind in his wake a series of female victims who have been beaten, sexually assaulted, and are murdered in a similar manner. The defendant obviously took delight in humiliating his victims, even in death. This break in the LA murders would soon lead to dozens of breaks in cold cases across the country. What led Samuel Little to confess to more than 90 murders, and how did a Texas Ranger get him to crack?
I think about it all the time. Yeah. That's why I remember, because I think about it all of my.
Find out why investigators believed Little after years of lies. I'm Sarah Goldenberg. That's next on episode 2 of To Catch a Killer, Samuel Little.
And you can watch the second episode tomorrow night right here on 19 News. And if you want to watch it again, we are posting the entire series online on our app and streaming device.
I want to thank you, Channel 3 News, because if it wasn't for y'all, we wouldn't know where to begin. We'd still be stuck.
After more than 30 years of questions, a family says they now know the nation's most prolific serial killer murdered their loved one.
WREG investigator Jessica Gertler explains how our drawing shared right here on our newscast led to the answers this family needed.
It took 32 painful years.
32 years.
To find out what happened.
Ugh.
Sending chills through Brittany's tally. She was just 5 years old when her mother, Zena Marie Jones, never came home in July 1990.
What did you hear over the years?
I've heard a lot of stories.
Stories she and her aunt Vicki Weddington refused to believe.
But in the back of our head, we always thought that maybe she was still alive out here. Maybe she had just lost her mind, didn't know where she was at.
They held on to hope until the fall of 2019, when the family was watching News Channel 3, and this sketch appeared on their TV. A portrait hand-painted by Samuel Little, who the FBI deems the most prolific serial killer in U.S. history. He was serving a life sentence for murder when he admitted to killing 93 women, mostly by strangulation, between the 1970s and 2005. He said he preyed on vulnerable women involved in prostitution and addicted to drugs.
North Little Rock. Tell me what that girl looked like.
Oh, man, I loved her. I forget her name. Oh, wait. I think it was Ruth.
He gave intricate details only the killer would know.
I pulled her out of the car. She's too big for me to carry her. So I just pulled her out of the car and laid her on that trash that was lit there.
Little also drew these pictures of some of his victims for the FBI, including this woman from Memphis.
I'm like, oh my God, this her.
We put the family in contact with authorities after airing Little's drawing.
When you saw it then, you knew.
Yeah, we just about knew. Mm-hmm.
Memphis Police cold case detectives and a Shelby County special prosecutor spoke to Little in prison before he died in 2020. He told them sometime between the mid-80s and 90s, he met a woman on Crump Boulevard. He strangled her, drove her across the bridge to Arkansas, and dumped her body in the Mississippi River.
When he said he killed one in Memphis and up to around 3rd and Crump, a light bulb went off in my head because we lived on Crump and Mason for so many years.
Detectives worked with the Crittenden County Sheriff's Office and were able to tie Little to an unidentified body pulled from the river in 1990. WREG covered the scene back then and reported a fisherman found the body. It had been on the shore for a couple of weeks. She was wearing the clothing Little described.
The body was removed here and then taken to a crime lab in Arkansas, where a piece of the remains was submitted and a DNA profile was created. In January of 2021, MPD detectives collected DNA samples from family members of potential victims to see if there was a match.
I went downtown, they just get the mouth swab, and they said it'd be like a year before they could get it back, so.
A little more than a year later, on April 21st.
We got a call letting us know that the DNA came back 98.99% that it was Zena.
I dropped the phone, but it was like, it was a relief, but it hurt. I cried.
The news came 5 days after Jones's birthday. She would have turned 62 years old.
I just think about what she was going through at that moment, like what happened and how she probably fought for her life.
A monster, a demon. He just, I feel so sorry for all the other families that's going through this and still don't know.
Jones was a young mother, a loving sister, a caring and funny person. Her family says she was the life of the party.
She always used to sing, and she always used to dance. And yes, and she used to make this song, Banana Fana, Bovana. Whatever your name was, like Tammy Whammy, Bovammy, she'll do something like this. She always did that.
The memories and endless questions were all this family had for the past 32 years.
It brought the closure that I needed.
Now, they can rest.
So I think she's at peace now, and I think she's glad we found her.
Jessica Gertler, WREG News Channel 3.
Hopefully that family can get some peace. And the family said it is working to find out where her body is so they can bring it back to Memphis and have a proper funeral.
Confirmation that a prolific serial killer did in fact stalk Metro Atlanta more than 40 years after Fulton County police found a strangled woman's body. Investigators are now linking that murder to Samuel Little.
Joe Hankey talked with Fulton County detectives who confirmed Little's confession.
Jeff, Samuel Little has confessed to a total of 93 murders across the country. According to the FBI, they say they believe all of his confessions. Samuel Little says they took place over 35 years. Investigators over the past year have been able to officially link 50 of those murder cases across the country to Little, including now a murder of a Georgia woman in 1977. In February, the FBI released this sketch saying it is the work of convicted murderer Samuel Little and his memory of one of his 93 victims. Little gave investigators drawings of many of his victims, and he described this one as a white woman and offered specifics about her height, weight, clothing, job, and said she was around 28 years old and from Griffin. Today, Fulton County Police confirmed they linked Little's confession and drawing to the 1977 murder of Leanne Helms. Little had more than a dozen run-ins with police over his lifetime, including here in Georgia, but he was never convicted of murder anywhere until 2014. He's now serving 3 consecutive life sentences for murders in California. It is from prison that Little has been sharing drawings of his victims, which the FBI describes as mostly sex workers or drug addicts. In prison, Little has also been giving confessions of each murder to Texas Ranger James Holland, who interviewed Little almost daily.
I parked the car facing out where I didn't see anybody coming in. So I pulled her out of the car.
Fulton County Police have now confirmed Helms' body was found in 1977 near Union City in the intersection of Oakley Road and Oakley Industrial Boulevard. By email, a county detective told 11 Alive, on June 27, 1977, upon arrival, officers were met by the 911 caller. He is with the Department of Transportation and was working in the area. He had stopped work to eat lunch and had walked back into the woods to use the bathroom when he found the body. 3 days later, Helms' cause of death was determined to be strangulation. Recently, Fulton County detectives sent a picture of Helms to Little, and he confessed to murdering her. And Fulton County police tell me they have talked with Helms' family about this investigation and are now working with the district attorney to move forward with prosecuting this case. But I'm told with Little already serving multiple life sentences and having confessed to 90-plus murders across the country, it is unlikely we will see him brought here to Georgia to face those charges.